Good morning, everybody. Happy Thursday. We have an amazing show for everybody today. What do we have, Krystal?
Indeed we do. We got a great panel. Emily Jashinsky and fan favorite Andrew Feldman will be here. We've got Jeff Stein on the very latest from the Biden administration and their spending plans. We've got Gary Chambers. He's a candidate for Congress. He's launched a really interesting new organization organizing in the South. But we wanted to start with what is some truly historic news coming out of the Biden administration.
Very big, and it seems to be a reversal from where Dr. Fauci and many others have been pointing to. Let's put this up there on the screen. The Biden administration is going to back COVID-19 vaccine patent waivers. This was announced yesterday by Katherine Tai. She's the U.S. Trade Representative. Let's put her tweet up there on the screen, in which she says, these extraordinary times and circumstances call for extraordinary measures. The U.S. supports the waiver of IP protections on COVID-19 vaccines to help end the pandemic and will actively participate in WTO negotiations to make that happen. So that comes ahead of a resolution drafted by India and South Africa asking for waiver of vaccine IP. But there's still a lot in terms of what is there, as in the U.S. did not say specifically they're backing TRIPS. So you were telling me about this. And another thing that I see here in terms of what a roadblock is don't forget that when our government is not the only one at the whims of pharmaceutical pressure. The European Union is very heavily guarded of its pharmaceutical industry and apparently has not yet signed on to this way and has been actually actively standing in the way. Any change to international IP rules requires unanimous consent, and that unanimous consent, even if the U.S. were to support it, could still be blocked by the European Union.
So let's start with the good news, and I think Li Fong put this in perspective in a tweet. He says, look, this is truly historic given the recent ugly history on these issues. In the late 90s, the Clinton administration, U.S. government applied massive pressure against South Africa for breaking patent protections on critical HIV/AIDS drugs. Bush administration did the same thing to Thailand. Of course, we know Trump administration's position was to stand in opposition to lifting patent protection. First 100 days of the Biden administration, they were really on the fence with this one. Yeah. And as recently as yesterday, Fauci seemed to be indicating that they were heading in the opposite direction. Clearly, there was public pressure and scrutiny brought to bear that helped to impact this ultimate decision, and it truly does matter a lot. It is one of the first times, I think we can say, in the Biden administration where he really has stood up to power. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is the first thing that I've seen. The Afghanistan decision, I would put in there as well.
That one also.
So I would put this as sort of like the second place where he's really stood up to power and corporate industry, and they are not happy. Look at the share prices. Pfizer, Moderna, BioNTech shares absolutely fall off a cliff. Of course, I look at this and it makes me happy because it seems like at least these manufacturers and the investors involved feel like this is real and like this is going to matter and it's going to have teeth and it's going to impact them. So that's the good side, and I want to give them all the credit in the world for bucking recent history across Democratic and Republican administrations to make this historic move.
Yeah.
Here's the cautionary pieces, as you're pointing out. Number one, the TRIPS waiver is what was offered by South Africa and India. The Biden administration isn't saying here they support the TRIPS waiver.
They said negotiate, right.
They say they want to start negotiations essentially from scratch. So let's see what the details are. Number two, as you said, the U.S. is not the only one who was standing in the way of lifting patent protections. You have the EU and you also have Canada. Do they get on board? How much pressure does the U.S. bring to bear to get those partners on board? Because as you said, it has to be unanimous consent. And then the other piece of this is just lifting the patent protections, a critical gatekeeping step. Manufacturers around the world are also going to need help with the technological know-how. That is something else that the Biden administration can pressure these companies to provide so that this isn't just a right in name only, that it actually means supply is increased. So those are the pieces that we have to continue to watch to see if they take the steps and apply the pressure where this isn't just like them being able to have a PR win saying they support it in theory, but nothing ever actually comes of it. Do they bring the pressure to bear to make this a reality and make it so that it actually has an impact on global vaccine supply? That's what we're going to be watching for.
Yeah, that's right. And pharma, of course, is really, really upset
they're furious.
And so this is what we have seen. We've already got a statement out from pharma. They said this decision will sow confusion between public and private partners, further weaken already strained supplies, and foster the proliferation of counterfeit vaccines, handing over American innovations to countries looking to undermine our leadership in biomedical diversity. I do think this is the key, which is that it's not like nobody's taking money away from Pfizer. So yesterday, Pfizer's profits came out. They have made $1 billion approximately in pre-tax profits from this vaccine, $900 million. Moderna's earnings, they come out today, very likely to be somewhere within the same range. They've been compensated plenty. Just to give people an idea, the vaccine currently is 1/4 of all of Pfizer revenue, $3.5 billion just the 3 months of their year.
Wow.
So they've made a lot of money. And you know what? They have probably reaped us, what, trillions of dollars in benefit? So you've been well compensated for your job. Thank you very much, vaccine IP. Now you've got $1 billion in profit. You can go do whatever you need to do.
Yeah.
Same thing whenever it comes to Moderna. Same thing in Johnson & Johnson, AstraZeneca as well. All of these people in public-private partnership, the whole part is partnership. So they don't get to socialize, or they don't get to basically privatize what the public has put in terms of the immense effort put in by the government. I think you did a Operation Warp Speed radar where you were talking about how an army commander had to go out there and like move broken down trucks, literally moving, you know, supplies and everything across the country. I'm sorry, those are taxpayer resources. That means that what you have been given is just simply not only yours. Some of it's yours, but not all of it.
Right.
And I also think they were doing tremendous damage to the vaccine case by talking about profits and booster shots. And people were saying, like, well, wait, how are we, like, I thought you said we just get the vaccine and then we're good. And then these guys are on investor calls where they're like, well, we expect the ability to possibly manufacture booster shots. And all those people are like, wait, you have to keep getting a shot for like every single year. It's going to be like the
salivating at the chance to lift the prices as soon as they technically declare the pandemic
over.
We
can't allow this stuff to happen. Not after 1 year and a half. I mean, trillions of dollars lost to the global economy and more. Like I said, if they had manufactured it themselves and they had it ready to go day one, that's a different story. But that's not the story.
Right. You're so correct about that. That was my favorite ridiculous criticism of this decision. Right. I saw some healthcare executives and former executives like, well, who's going to make the vaccine next time if you're going to cut off the...
They'll pay you $1 billion to do
this. This is going to be one of the most profitable drugs in history. Mm-hmm. Pfizer and Moderna, they're all making massive amounts of money. And I'm probably more of a radical than you on this. Look, this stuff came from the public sector. Don't give me your like, oh, we spent all this money on research and development. The U.S. taxpayer developed the mRNA technology that then gets sold to the private sector and you get to profit off of it. Now, that is the way it's been essentially since the 90s with the Bayh-Dole Act and the way that we handle that now. And that's the reality of the system that we have now. But imagine the greed that you're raking these hundreds of millions of profits, but it is never, ever enough. And again, to give credit to Biden here, and again, we're going to wait. We're going to see the details. We're going to judge them as they come in and whether they actually bring the pressure to make this a reality. But pharma was throwing everything at stopping this very move. I just saw an article yesterday about how Senator Menendez is getting all kinds of pharma cash in the door, not just from the companies and their PACs, but also directly from the executives. You can see, we talked to Dan Marins about the way that they're trying to marshal their allies in Congress to push back on all of this. That war is going to continue, by the way, but they have thrown everything in their arsenal at stopping this move. You also had Bill Gates, who we know the Biden administration met with, pushing very hard in the other direction. So even to make this statement was a tremendously significant move in the right direction. And we'll wait and see what the details are and what ultimately comes of it. But I think that this was, you know, this was exciting to see and frankly surprising to see.
Very surprising.
Based on some of the previous track record of Joe Biden throughout his career, but even in these early days of the administration. One other thing I wanted to point out here, which Adam Johnson pointed out on Twitter, which I think is really funny. Hmm. Rachel Maddow, for the first time last night, covered this.
Mm-hmm.
Once, of course, the Democrats...
Once the controversy is gone.
Once the controversy, and once Biden actually gets on the right side, then suddenly the cheerleading, and of course, this is the right position and everything. There was zero coverage of it before he actually made the decision when she could have been involved in pressuring him in the right way.
That's
just
funny.
A little side note
on
the
media coverage. Well, she was too busy covering the latest developments around Bill. I saw Rod Rosenstein tweet trending on Twitter yesterday. I'm like, what the? What year is it? It was like a Jumanji thing.
What?
And yeah, there's some, I was like, what? What is going on here? And just some Rachel Maddow segment about some memo or whatever. They're never going to let this one die, folks.
They never will. Always focused on the important things. All right, we're going to tell you what's on our radar. So that's next.